Dear brothers and sisters, peace be with you. Praise the Lord that we are continuing to read Matthew chapter 1, starting from the bottom half of verse 6. The author of the Gospel book of Matthew, he wrote from the genealogy of Jesus Christ. He divided the genealogy into three sections very wisely. The first section from Abraham and ended with David. Abraham was the first one called by God. From him, the whole race was brought out. If you count them carefully, from verse 2 to verse 6, there were 14 names that indicated there were 14 generations and had produced David. In all this genealogy, only David was called as a king. This shows us that from the time man was called, after 14 generations, a king was produced. Among the descendants of Abraham, there were two groups of people. One group is his earthly descendants, that's the nation of Israel in the Old Testament, and the other group is his heavenly descendants. Those are the people who will be in the kingdom of heavens one day. We mentioned before that the Gospel of Matthew is written from the angle of Jesus as a king. His audiences are the kingdom people, including earthly kingdom, the kingdom of Israel, and the people of the kingdom of heaven, the New Testament believers. When we read the gospel books, we need to know who are the audience. In the four gospel books, Luke also records the genealogy of Jesus Christ, and Luke's focus was to introduce Jesus as the perfect man, so his recording of the genealogy was different from Matthew's. He started from Jesus and traced backward. It's recorded in Luke chapter 3, verses 23-38. And the overlapping of these two genealogies were from David to Abraham. Luke chapter 3:32 says, David, the son of Jesse, the son of Obed, the son of Boaz, etc. And to verse 34, Judah, the son of Jacob, the son of Isaac, the son of Abraham. Here we also see 14 names. The records in Matthew and in Luke are the same. However, Matthew starts from Abraham and Luke did not stop at Abraham. He continued to trace back until in verse 38. Enosh, the son of Seth, the son of Adam, the son of God. Because Luke wanted to present Jesus as the perfect man, so he has to trace all the way back to the origin, to God's creation, that's Adam. So from another angle, we can say that Gospel of Luke is written for the whole human race, because God made everything from one man. Adam was the same origin for all the human beings. Let's take another look at Luke chapter 3, verse 31. In Luke's records, we see that he recorded that Nathan, the son of David. But in Matthew 1:6, it says, David the king begot Solomon by her who had been the wife of Uriah. David had many wives and many children. In Matthew's record, David's son, Solomon, and everyone after him who's in the line of the kingships. But Luke recorded David's other son, Nathan. This tells us that the genealogy recorded in Luke is the genealogy of Mary's. For Mary also a descendant of David, but they are not in the line of the kingships. They were the descendants of David's other son, Nathan. With this understanding, that's returned to Matthew. From David the king, Matthew continued to record the following 14 generations. They were all on the line of the kings. Verse 6, David the king begot Solomon by her who had been the wife of Uriah. This was a very unusual way to describe this. The Holy Spirit did not record the name of David's wife, but said that she's the wife of Uriah. Who was this woman? It's recorded in 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 2-27. At the most powerful and prosperous time of David. He had established a very strong kingdom of Israel, so he slacked back and undisciplined. He got up from the bed one evening and walked around on the rooftop of the palace, and he saw a beautiful woman bathing. She's the wife of Uriah, named Bathsheba. Uriah was David's royal general. David coveted the beauty of Bathsheba, so he slept with her and plotted to murder Uriah on the battlefield. This had tainted David's whole life. God sent prophet Nathan to rebuke him directly, and he told David of God's judgments, recorded in 2 Samuel 12, verse 10 to 12. Now, therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house, because you have despised me, and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, behold, I will raise up adversity against you from your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes, and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this sin. For you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel in the broad daylight. David repented immediately and said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. Nathan replied, the Lord has taken away your sin. You are not going to be to die, but because by doing this you have made the enemies of the Lord show utter contempt, the son born to you will die. David wrote a psalm, Psalm 51, specifically for his repentance over this sin. This psalm was one of the most loved psalms by all the believers throughout the ages. He started with this, his plea to the Lord. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. After he confessed his sin, he continued on verse 10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Eventually, he understood God's grace, and he continued in verse 17. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. David also paid a heavy price for his sin, and the Holy Spirit specifically inspired Matthew to include that she's the wife of Uriah when he wrote the genealogy of Jesus Christ in the book of Matthew. After David's repentance to the Lord and was forgiven, he slept with Bathsheba again, and they had a son, Solomon. God loved Solomon and used Solomon to build the temple for him. He granted Solomon all kinds of wisdom and discernments. While he was alive, Israel was at her most glorious state. But what God said to David through the prophet Nathan, the sword shall never depart from your house, it fulfilled on the descendants of Solomon. Verse 7. Solomon begot Rehoboam. At the time of Rehoboam, the kingdom of Israel divided into two. The southern kingdom of Judah had only two tribes, Judah and Benjamin, and the other 10 tribes rebelled against the house of Judah and became the northern kingdom of Israel. This also shows us the principle of remnant. Normally, what God chooses will not be the majority. The northern kingdom of Israel, even though they have 10 tribes, they had 9 different dynasties, and they were destroyed by BC 722. They were defeated by the Assyrian Empire. And the southern Judah, even though they only had 2 tribes, but the ones sat on the thrones have always been the descendants of David, except one incident and cause 3 generations were not counted by the Holy Spirit. They could always raise up good kings to lead the Israel people back to God. The southern kingdom of Judah also was defeated by the Babylonian Empire on BC 586. Let's return to Matthew 1:7. After reborn, Israel divided into the south and the north. What Matthew recorded were the kings of the southern kingdom of Judah. They were all David's descendants, and they were all kings. Verse 7 and 8. Solomon begat Rehoboam. Rehoboam begat Abijah. And Abijah begat Asa. Asa begat Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat begat Jehoram. And Jehoram begat Uzziah. If you compare this with the records in 1 Chronicles chapter 3 verse 11 and 12, there as you see Jehoshaphat begat Jehoram, and Jehoram begat Ahaziah. And Ahaziah begat Joash. Joash begat Amaziah. Amaziah begat Azariah. Azariah is the same as Uzziah, recorded in Matthew. Azariah begat Jotham. Then the record became the same as in Matthew. This tells us that from Jehoram to Uzziah, there were three generations did not recorded in Matthew. They are Ahaziah, Joash, and Amaziah. Why? The most possible reason is from the Ten Commandments of the Moses Law recorded in Exodus chapter 20, verse 5. You shall not bow down to carve images, nor to serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me. Idol worshippers, God will visit their sin to the third and fourth generations. Let's compare to the records in 2 Kings, chapter 8, verse 16 and 17. It says, Jehoram, son of Jehoshaphat, son of Jehoshaphat began his reign as king of Judah. He was 32 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 8 years. He walked in the ways of the kings of Israel, as the house of Ahab had done. The northern kings of Israel, almost none of the kings were good kings. Among those bad kings, the worst one was King Ahab, because he married Jezebel and brought in the foreign god Baal, idol worshiping into the Israelite people. Jehoram married the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel, named Athaliah. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord. Nevertheless, for the sake of his servant David, the Lord was not willing to destroy Judah. Because of the evil thing Jehoram did, after he died, his son Ahaziah succeeded him as king for just a year, and his wife Athaliah seized the throne and became the de facto ruler in Judah, and she reigned for 6 years. In 2 Kings chapter 11, verses 1 to 3, when Athaliah the mother of Ahaziah, saw that her son was dead, she proceeded to destroy the whole royal family. But Jehoshaphat, the daughter of King Jehoram and sister of Ahaziah, took Joash, son of Ahaziah, and stole him away from among the royal princes who were about to be murdered. She put him and his nurse in a bedroom to hide him from Ataliah. So he was not killed. He remained hidden with his nurse at the temple of the Lord for 6 years, while Ataliah ruled the land. At the seventh year, Joash took back the throne and passed down to his son, Amaziah. And after Amaziah died, the people made his son, Azariah, as king, as recorded in 2 Kings chapter 14, verse 21. It says, then all the people of Judah took call Uzziah, who was 16 years old, and made him king in place of his father, Amaziah. Uzziah was a good king, but because Jehoram married the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel, and they worship idols, this offended God greatly. So the next three generations after them, the Holy Spirit did not recognize them, and therefore skipped three generations from Jehoram to Uzziah directly. Verse 9 and 10. Uzziah begot Jotham. Jotham begot Ahaz. And Ahaz begot Hezekiah. Hezekiah begot Manasseh. Manasseh begot Amon. And Amon begot Josiah. Josiah was the last good king of the kingdom of Judah. 2 Kings chapter 22, verse 1 and 2 says, Josiah was eight years old when he became king, and he reigned 31 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Jedidah, the daughter of Adiah of Bozkath, and he did what was right in the sight of the Lord, and walked in all the ways of his father David. He did not turn aside to the right hand or to the left. Then the high priest found the book of law from the temple, and they were reading it to the king. 2 Kings chapter 22, verse 11 says, when the king heard the words of the book of the law, he torn his robes. He gave orders to the priest to go and inquire of the Lord for him and for all of Judah. Was it because our fathers have not obeyed the words of this book, so the Lord's anger had burned against them? During the time of Josiah, he torn down the altars of the foreign gods and do everything according to the book of the law. He commanded the people to observe the Passover to the Lord again. Holy Spirit's judgment to Josiah was recorded in 2 Kings chapter 23, verse 25. Neither before nor after Josiah was there a king like him who turned to the Lord as he did, with all his heart and with all his soul and with all his strength, in accordance with all the law of Moses. In Matthew's record, in the kingship of the line of David, he stopped on Josiah. Verse 11, Josiah begot Johanan and his brothers about the time they were carried away to Babylon. According to the kings, there were four kings after Josiah, including his son, Johanan, Johanan's brother, Jehoiakim's son, Jehoiachin. This is Johannes recorded. Jehoiachin is the Johanna recorded in Matthew. And then Johannes' uncle, Zedekiah. These were during the last few years of the kingdom of Judah, very chaotic times between Josiah and Jeconiah. Jeconiah. There's one generation was skipped, and during that generation, Egyptian Pharaoh interfered with the ruling of the kingdom, and therefore this also did not count by the Holy Spirit. So the second section of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, those who sat on the thrones from David to Josiah, total of 14 names, 14 generations. The records in the book of Matthew is not according to the history, but according to the Holy Spirit. If the Holy Spirit did not count them, then Matthew did not record them. This is a warning to us. The time we have on earth were all measured by God. We have to ask ourselves, is our everyday living and acting pleasing to God? Are they accountable in God's eyes? How other people see us is not important, but what's important is how God sees us. Let's pray. Lord, help us to understand your words, understand the will you have for us, that every moment we live on the earth are accountable in your eyes. Help us to set our minds in the things above, to live a life that's pleasing to you. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen.